As you know, yesterday I brought a bipartisan group of legislators together to ask whether they would support my efforts to call a special session for emergency legislation to implement a statewide mask mandate. I convened the meeting because, as we have discussed previously, case rates and hospitalizations are spiking in counties that opted out of my July mask order. And today, Kansas surpassed 1,000 total COVID-19 deaths. To put this in context, the state did not reach 500 COVID deaths until September, roughly 6 months after the pandemic began. It took a little over 6 weeks for another 500 Kansans to die. Yesterday's call was productive, and I believe both sides were acting in what they felt were in the best interests of Kansans. I began the conversation by asking legislative leaders to reconvene in a special session to pass bipartisan legislation to restore my ability to require mask wearing across Kansas. In response, Republican leaders asked if, before calling a special session, I would consider a strategy of reaching out to local leaders to implement their own mask requirement. I agreed with the stipulation that legislative leaders, in conjunction with their caucuses, reach out with me to county and city leadership, as well as stakeholder groups, and that we move forward as quickly as possible. We cannot afford to wait another moment to begin this process. I have directed my staff to put all of our energy into this strategy. However, if we are unable to convince communities to voluntarily implement a mask mandate, I will move expeditiously to find another way to implement. Since Kansas has reported 3,369 positive COVID cases and 31 new deaths. This brings us to a total of 82,045 cases, 3,752 hospitalizations, and it is with deep sadness that I say we have reached 1,007 deaths. I offer my sincere condolences to the family, friends, and loved ones of those who have succumbed to COVID-19. And in acknowledgement of their losses, today I ordered flags to be flown at half staff statewide, effective immediately until sundown, Friday, October 30th. Though case numbers I shared moments ago offer some insight into Kansas's current pandemic response, they do not tell the full story of how the virus is moving through our state. So before I move into today's announcement, I want to give a brief recap on what we have learned since my COVID update last Wednesday. Last week, our state's 7-day rolling average test positivity rate was 10.54%, which is just above the 10% threshold recommended to open schools and businesses. On Monday, for the third week in a row, Kansas broke the record for the highest number of new cases of any reporting period at nearly 2,500. Which we broke again today at over 3,300. Hospitals, particularly in our rural areas, continue to see increasing numbers of COVID-19 patients, putting a strain on bed capacity and on staff. Though case numbers in Kansas may be increasing, as always, there is still time to turn around our virus response. We're learning more every day about the effectiveness of COVID-19 mitigation strategies and public health guidelines, especially mask use. A study conducted by researchers at the University of Kansas found that counties with mask mandates have effectively stopped the virus transmission from increasing. Counties with no mandate have seen infection rates climb. A report from the Institute for Health Metrics and Evaluation at the University of Washington showed that strict adherence to mask orders could save 130,000 American lives by the end of February. If not, United States death toll could reach 500,000 in that time. It's clear that until a vaccine is widely available and deployed, Mask usage is one of our most important strategies for keeping Kansas schools and businesses open. Masks are just one piece, however. We must also increase testing capacity, isolate those who test positive, identify those who have been in close contact, and communicate the importance of quarantining to keep our communities safe. And that leads me to the framework for our new unified testing strategy. Over the last 4 weeks, a team at the Kansas Department of Health and Environment, under the direction of Special Advisor to the Governor, Dr. Marcy Nielsen, has been working diligently to develop the strategy in a way that best fits Kansas. Broadly speaking, the new strategy identifies where Kansas currently stands and paints a picture of where we need to go and how we can get there. To give you some background, since the pandemic began, local and state public health departments have largely focused their efforts on testing only those who have symptoms of COVID-19 or testing in areas where we're experiencing outbreaks. We've made great strides in improving outbreak response over the past several months. However, to effectively locate the virus in our communities, keep Kansans safe, keep kids in school, and keep our businesses open, we must do more. We need to expand testing to include regular screening for the virus before it spreads. And that's what the new unified testing strategy is developed to do. It will coordinate both public and private COVID-19 testing efforts across Kansas to allow for broader routine screening in places like schools and nursing homes to stop community spread before it starts. With the investment of Spark funding, which was recently competitively bid and will soon be announced, we can nearly double the amount of testing we're doing in Kansas by year's end. That will move us from a total of 600,000 COVID-19 tests to date to more than 1 million by the end of 2020. We will also expand beyond the types of testing we are conducting from just diagnostic to screening and then surveillance. KDHU will be working with our partners in the private sector to expand labs and supplies, enhance data and reporting, provide support for isolation and quarantining, and increase our public communications about controlling the virus's spread. This is especially important for populations at high risk, but also for businesses across the state worried about keeping their workforces safe and their doors open. A unified testing strategy will be resource intensive, but will help us to save lives and rebuild our economy. The graph behind me, this one, visually demonstrates how this will work. For those populations at the highest risk, and that's located here in the green section, state and local public health officials will continue to investigate outbreaks, but also regularly screen for the virus and isolate those who test positive. For populations at medium risk, and that's in the blue band, health officials will once again continue to investigate outbreaks, but will also use surveillance testing, which uses methods like testing wastewater for signs of COVID-19. Through the new strategy, we also will cast a wider net when it comes to accessing information and resources for our COVID-19 response. If you recall, I recently announced that Kansas had joined the Rockefeller Foundation COVID-19 Testing Solutions Group. Today, I'm pleased to report that Kansas is now part of the collaborative effort funded by the National Institutes of Health to improve COVID-19 testing for underserved and vulnerable populations. The University of Kansas Medical Center is one of 32 institutions across the United States that will focus on increasing testing in populations disproportionately affected by the pandemic. Referred to as the Rapid Acceleration of Diagnostics Initiative, 10 counties will be working with a KU Med research team to build a learning collaborative that will help support our most vulnerable populations and help inform the work of Kansas's unified testing strategy. I know that oftentimes when we think of testing, we may not consider the whole picture. We only think about the test itself and then receiving the results on our iPhones afterward. But there is so much more for our public health officials to consider. We need comprehensive, accurate data that health officials can analyze to determine our most vulnerable populations or locations so that the state can respond accordingly. We need access to labs that have sufficient testing capacity. We need reliable transportation to move samples from health facilities to labs where they can be tested for COVID-19. The unified testing strategy has all of that in mind and more. Through this approach, we can work together with local health departments to analyze what we have, what we need, and how we can get it. Last week, I visited Salon Chemistry in Wichita to learn more about the owner's COVID-19 mitigation strategies and commend them for their diligent efforts to keep Kansans safe. While I was there, we talked about how hard it had been for them when the virus spread and I was required to close down certain businesses last spring. At that time, our state did not have access to sufficient testing supplies or PPE to ensure customers and employers could stay safe. We had little understanding of how the virus spreads or how it manifested, and we have learned a lot over the last several months. With that evolving knowledge and understanding, and with a unified testing strategy, we can provide businesses like Salon Chemistry with certainty that they'll be able to continue operation this winter and beyond. Adding the unified testing strategy to our toolbox, along with universal mask usage, social distancing, and avoidance of mass gatherings, we can contain this virus and give our scientists time to develop a vaccine that will allow us to resume our normal activities. And with that, I'll take questions.
Governor, you mentioned the new numbers in this, the big increase in cases and all of that. And how long are you going to give the this approach, this, I forget what you called it.
Collaborative, bipartisan.
Yes, it had strategy.
Voluntary, all of that.
Strategy.
Yes.
How long are you going to give that to work?
Not long, John.
What's not long?
I don't have a firm drop dead date, but I'll know it when I get there. You know, some of it will just depend upon how much progress we're making using that approach. But you know, we are just losing Kansans day in and day out. You know, this cannot continue. We cannot continue to leave our individuals and our businesses and our schools at risk like this. We've got to do something. And I think it would be ideal if we can work out a strategy in cooperation with our local units of government to ensure that people are taking all the precautions that they need to up to and including wearing masks when in public.
Governor, you touched on mask wearing. There is this website, Unmask Together, that is currently trying to get large crowds of people to buy the mask mandate this weekend here in Topeka. What are your kind of thoughts on that effort?
I did see that. I would just hope that the establishments that get targeted with that, come up with a way to deal with it so that their employees are safe and their other customers are safe.
Governor, do you know maybe around when, you would decide the winners of the bid for the testing money?
I'm sorry, say that again.
Do you know around when you decide,
who gets the bids? For the testing?
Yeah.
I believe that all of the RFPs are back. I believe that there's some communication going back and forth. Details are being worked out. I'm hoping, there was a chance that even as late as today or as early as today that we would be able to make those announcements. That may still happen, hopefully no later than the end of the week. That was the first 50, yep.
Does that go for these contracts, or is there another?
I think there will be there is another round of funding that I expect will come. I think that's $30 million. And if we're able to do that, I think that we'll be able to satisfy our testing requirements through the end of the year.
Governor, what gives you any hope? And county commissioners, what have you heard from them as to why they're not having a mandate right now?
Well, you know, we sent Lieutenant Governor out on a mask up tour, so he's already been out to Northwest Kansas, and you know, I think it's his feeling is that, you know, some of the county commissioners are really ready to go. They recognize it. You know, this is where, you know, the Norton nursing home, but also into the community happened. And I think that the jolt of that, you know, if you look at where spread is really high and the percentage of positives are very high, you're really looking at those far northwest counties. And he said that, you know, a number of the commissioners are starting to see the light and are really reconsidering. So I'm thinking if we can have some conversations that we, and hear what they have to say. You know, is there a way that they can put a mask mandate in that works for them? You know, there are a number of mask mandates across the state right now that, you know, either counties modified mine somewhat or cities have imposed mask mandates. You know, if we were to do a statewide mask mandate, we would grandfather those in because they were developed for that particular community. And so if these counties out northwest can come up with, you know, some modifications to the mask mandate that would work for them, you know, we'll partner with them and get that done. But I think there are probably a number of counties that are really waiting, hoping that we'll reach out. Well, I'm gonna take first one step at a time right now, and let's work with the counties and the cities to you know, help them put in a mask mandate, and then obviously if that doesn't work and doesn't work very quickly, you know, then, you know, everything else is still on the table.
One more question.
Well, what is the next step in that process? What do people see tomorrow or Friday?
Well, we're convening a meeting with you know, legislative leadership. Whoever, we asked them yesterday to do some point people who would work with the governor's office on this, and then we're convening meetings with those folks and the League of Municipalities, which represents all the cities, and then the Kansas Association of Counties represents all the counties. So we'll start with the leadership there and then figure out the best strategy for working with the individual cities and counties.
Thank
you. Go ahead.
The counties essentially skated on their responsibility and the effects of their orders on knocking down the mask mandate. Are they being held responsible for what's going on?
I think that you know, the counties and county commissioners perhaps feel that they are representing the wants and desires of their particular constituents. I think we can have conversations that might give them some more information to suggest that the wants and needs of their citizens are such that it would be in their constituents' best interest if they mandate the mask.
Thank you.